Harper Audio presents Extreme You. Step up, stand out, kick ass, repeat. By Sarah Robb O'Hagan. Read by me, the author, and Sandy Rustin. For Mum and Dad, Extreme Jenny and Honourable John, for showing me there were big mountains to climb and for letting me figure out how to climb them. And for Liam, Sam, Joe and Gabby, for making the entire journey worthwhile. It's not the mountain we conquer, but ourselves. Sir Edmund Hillary. Introduction. Sitting at the front of the auditorium, waiting to deliver a speech at an undergrad business conference at Harvard, I began to have an uncomfortable feeling. I was to be the keynote speaker, the opener at this event, with about 1,000 attendees from universities around the world, and my bloody MacBook would not connect to the conference organizer's projection equipment. Yep, that's right. Hundreds of young people were streaming through the doors and taking their seats as I stood there with sweat bullets on my forehead, wondering what kind of interpretive dance I was going to have to do for them if the damn projector wouldn't connect. To add a little more pressure, Donna Karen, a business hero of mine and a legend of the business world, was to be the closer. She wasn't even due to speak for another 5 hours, yet her people had already arrived to make sure her presentation was all set to work. Oh God, why didn't I have people to take care of such issues? This wasn't the first time that the tornado that is Sarah Robb O'Hagan had blown into an auditorium attempting to look perfectly polished and professional, when in fact behind the scenes I was anything but. The young woman who had organized the conference stood up to introduce me. She read out my bio word for word, and of course I knew what it said. It was the bio used in the promotional materials for the conference. The bio I gladly distributed because it gave the impression that I was a serious success story, a reinventor of brands who'd worked at Virgin and Nike, a workout queen who brought an athlete's mindset to business problems, one of Fast Company's most creative people in business, Ad Age's Women to Watch, a three-time recipient of Sports Business Daily's 40 Under 40 Award, and named by Forbes as one of the most powerful women in sports. Many of those accolades had come to me when I had served as global president of Gatorade, one of the world's most iconic sports brands, and led that brand through a major turnaround, a transformational journey from sports drink company to sports performance innovator, returning the once struggling business to healthy growth. After that, I had gone on to be president of Equinox, the world's premier fitness lifestyle company, named by Fast Company as one of 2015's most innovative companies in fitness. And now I am the CEO of Flywheel Sports, the awesome, fast-growing indoor cycling company. But as I listened to this aspiring young businesswoman describe me, something felt very wrong. What bothered me was not what she said, but what she left out. My bio made it sound as if I were this polished, perfect business fembot. It certainly didn't mention what most of my colleagues see in me. The wild storm of enthusiasm and determination, tempered by plenty of embarrassing trip-ups as I work hard to try to hold it all together. My bio also neglected to mention that for much of my life, the results I had delivered had been, at best, average. Sometimes I'd not quite made the team. Other times I'd been a disappointment. At still other times, I'd been what I can only describe as an epic fail. Yep, I'm that person who got fired not just once, but twice in my 20s. The first time, I was singled out as a rabble-rouser and nearly deported from the United States back to my home country of New Zealand because I didn't have an employer and a work visa to keep me here. The second job ended when I was laid off as part of a larger restructuring. 3 years of what I fondly refer to as my canyon of career despair. Hardly a picture-perfect journey. On the job, too, I've had plenty of seriously embarrassing screw-ups. Ideas that seemed huge in my mind, but shriveled to nothing in the marketplace. Despite all of that, though, by my late 30s, I was giving speeches at conferences where audience members would line up to meet me, asking, "How do you do it? Tell us your secret." My secret, if you really want to know, is that I'm about as far from perfect as you can get. But in my experience, perfection is overrated. Yes, I made it to president of a $5 billion global sports brand at a pretty early age. But I think all that happened exactly because I wasn't scared of my imperfections, contradictions, and attitude. Listen, I'm a big, bold, over-the-top, laugh-till-you-snort, opinionated, don't-sit-on-the-sidelines, mega-enthusiastic kind of gal. Simple things such as my giant man-sized feet were an early clue that I was never going to be perfect the way society defines it for us. But I figured that if I kept trying and experimenting to find where I was great and where I sucked, if I kept believing that I could excel somewhere, somehow, eventually I'd find my own path to my own kind of greatness. I chose the path of living my personality to its fullest to get where I wanted to go. And I've come to realize that I'm not alone. Angela Ahrens, Bodie Miller, Condoleezza Rice, Mr. Cartoon, Angela Lee Duckworth, Sam Cass, Casey Wasserman, Bozema St. John. You might wonder what a business leader, a downhill skier, a former Secretary of State, a tattoo artist, a psychologist, a chef, a sports business founder, and a music executive have in common. They just happen to be the best in the world at what they do. But none of them started their careers knowing exactly where their true greatness would lie. One of the great benefits of my career journey is the amazing opportunity I have had to meet and work with so many successful people from many different walks of life. I've had the chance to observe how they do what they do. Behind the accolades and the glowing media articles that say how awesome they are, you'll find that they have an extraordinary impact by embracing every aspect of themselves, the good and the bad, because they took risks and worked through the sometimes tough negative consequences. They didn't expect their greatness to just happen. Instead, they worked their asses off to outperform everyone around them with a potent mix of drive and humility. They are extremers, those who reach the summit of their potential by developing their unique mix of abilities in their own personal way. Anyone can do this. I call it developing extreme you, becoming the best you can be as only you can. Extreme you is not one fixed goal. It doesn't depend on the typical early indicators of success, high test scores, star turns in sports or the arts, membership in elite social and professional networks, or on flashy short-term achievements. The fact is, most of us don't make a big splash early, and most achievements, as the world judges them, soon fade. Nor is extreme you just a style or an attitude. Extremers have a ton of attitude, do we ever? But it goes far beyond surface dazzle. Extreme you is a lifelong method for discovering and making the most of what's in you, starting from wherever you are with your own diverse mix of interests, skills, and experiences. And yes, that includes setbacks, losses, weaknesses, and failures. Extremers discover that the more they develop themselves, the more new potential they find. They learn to embrace the support of others in making their extreme efforts, and to collaborate by bringing out the extreme in others. They are successful, yes, but on their own terms, almost as a byproduct of developing extreme you. Are you a dreamer? I know I was. As a kid growing up in New Zealand, I imagined I could have a big impact on the world. I was constantly searching for my calling, trying on different visions of my future. I dreamed I could be a famous tennis player, but then I had the small problem that I never won any tournaments. I thought I could win an Olympic swimming medal, but my parents weren't those kind of parents. They showed no interest in taking me to a pool at 5 every morning. I wanted to sing as beautifully as Dame Kerry Takanawa at the royal wedding, though I still don't think we should forgive Diana for that dress choice. But the choir director never picked me for solos. I thought I could be a famous actress, and I was certain my moment was coming when I tried out to play Sandy in our high school production of Grease. But you guessed it, I didn't even get picked to be one of the pink ladies. I was in the section of the chorus for people who don't belong on the stage. Now, don't get me wrong, I think I was considered bright, and my personality definitely stood out as bold and bossy. Oh, if I had a dollar for every time in high school I heard the line, "Sarah and company, would you please stop talking?" But no one ever found me reading chapter books in my crib or playing chess in my high chair, and despite what felt to me like Herculean efforts, if I'm going to be honest, I never really excelled at anything. I never made the top team in any sport or won a scholarship to university. I barely scraped by with B-level grades. I wasn't a jock or a homecoming queen or singled out as most likely to succeed. I definitely wasn't model beautiful, big feet, rugby player thighs, thanks Dad. I didn't have any well-connected uncles to help me skip over the line to a great internship. I never even earned an MBA. By now you may be wondering, who is this crazy New Zealander lady? Why is she talking to me? I'm writing this book because it's high time someone talks about a different, more fun, and more uniquely ownable path to making the most of our potential, a path open to most everyone. That day at Harvard, my own bio, with its list of accomplishments proceeding logically one to the next, made me feel uncomfortable because, like so many of the success stories people tell, it left out the most important part. Those stories so often make it sound as if the successful are the ones whose gifts and advantages become clear early and lead them to early, inevitable victories. Then they step confidently from one triumph to the next, building on those early wins. But that's definitely not how it happened for me, or for the many extremers I have talked to. I know there is another way. It was exactly because I didn't have one clear, natural gift. Because I was bold and loud and no one stereotype of a perfect petite female. And because I lacked dramatic early successes that I had to watch others win their accolades from the sidelines and feel so strongly, I want some of that. Because success didn't come easily, and because I kept bumping into authority figures telling me that I was too loud, too talkative, too mischievous, too bossy, I gained the hunger and the determination to fuel my inner drive. With that magic drive as my engine, I pressed on, and as an adult, I discovered that I actually did have a unique combination of characteristics, experiences, and skills that was distinctly and extremely me. And because I honed and developed them as my unique formula, I was able to overcome my average start and become world class. I created my own special way of finding success. The secret I found after my early disappointments was that when you aim for oversized achievement, you must make a choice. Every challenging situation, personal or professional, that comes with the possibility of serious success or failure will also come with pressure from others and from yourself. Pressure to conform to the accepted norms, edit yourself down, fit in, do what is usual and comfortable, and in so doing make yourself seem more average, more expected, and less threatening to the status quo, less of yourself. If you make that choice, you may find that you are well rewarded in the short run because you don't make anyone around you feel nervous or look bad. But it's also like playing a game of tennis on the defense. putting all your effort into not making mistakes and not losing points. It becomes very hard to break through and win because you're not playing your own game. The other choice is to embrace what I call extreme you, to confidently put all that is distinctive and relevant about yourself into everything you do. I bring a huge amount of passion to my work, and I have very little patience for those who don't. I show up intense, I give my all, I care. And although you might say that not everyone is wired that way, I would answer that many people, from colleagues to friends, have said the same thing to me. I never in a million years would have done.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.